The lead question is quite a serious question. It is very deep politically and philosophically, but significantly philosophically. It is very much important to understand the lead question, because if you don't have a correct philosophical perspective on the lead question, and then you will be dealing with secondary issues instead of dealing with the principal questions. And you confuse secondary questions as principal questions with regard to the question of but I'm worried about time because I see some people are already preparing to leave. I beg your indulgence. I would like to talk to you. Okay, thank you very much. The last question is the ANC resolution to expropriate land without compensation an answer to the land question? That is the question I have been asked to come and submit my answer to. First of all, let me begin by saying let us acknowledge that last month or this year, or last month, we have declared that this year is the year of Robert Mugabe's Sibeko. And secondly, we are on the month of March, the Sharpeville and Langa massacre. Isolated. These are two crucial milestones in the history of the African people. To reconquer that which they lost to conquest. It is important, I don't know what you had in mind, organizers, when you organized this event in between these 2 months, but I thank you for that. It is a time when the debate, which has such universal and intellectual and international significance, not just for Africans, but for the rest of the human race. The question really is, in the 21st century, how shall we remember ourselves as Africans? Shall we understand or shall we remember ourselves as perpetual slaves, servants to others, humiliated people, things of laughing stock? Is that the brand to which we want to bequeath to our children and generations to come? And it is important. Why is it important? Because this question, it is asked while the pretenders in the leadership of the Zanzibar liberation struggle in parliament pretend that they have done something about this question. Let me categorically say to you that the parliament and the democracy we talk about today is a mirage. Because democracy and parliamentary democracy is an expression of class power. Now, when did Africans have the power? We have the democratic right to be leaders, to be called with funny titles of president and prime ministers and ministers, and we are nothing different from the Bantu state leadership. Yes. Why do I say this? Why do I say this? I say this because I argue that before you can answer this question, you must be able to phrase and contextualize it and understand it in the context of history.
Yeah, come on. Yes. Come on.
When the Europeans conquered us and the British Parliament in 1909 passed the Union of South Africa Constitutive Act, which South Africa was then established in 1910, when they did that, they were building their own state. And we had nothing to do with it. South Africa is a political concept, is a settler colonial construct, and we have never been part of it.
Yeah, man.
And that created the split. This conception is important. And it's important for us to begin at this level. Because people talk about our country. People talk about our government. Talk about our economy. And yet, we have forgotten that you, the base, you, the foundation that South Africa was built upon.
Yes.
Africans are not South Africa. That is the correct framing, I argue. Settlers, European settlers came and conquered and established South Africa and they built their state. That was an expression of their socio-economic power.
Yeah.
We were conquered, we were defeated. And ever since then, what has happened that two movements of conception of the problem emerged within the African communities. Right? At some time back, it was known as a movement of Matigari.
Yeah.
They are assimilationists, they are assimilators. And those who consistently refuse this so-called civilizing spirit that came from the north. And this shaped the national liberation thinking in our country. It's a question of two line national contradictions. One, the assimilators, the products of missionary education, came with some form of enlightenment. They had a better understanding. The Rastafarians call understanding. Right? And they understood the struggle as a struggle against civil rights, violations.
Yeah.
And therefore the struggle was to struggle for a democratic South Africa, forgetting that what they call South Africa is an institution that has been built on the negation of our Africanness, our very being, both materially, spiritually, and physically. Lambete represents a rebellion. Lambete represents a spirit deposited to him by his ancestors, Abo Bambata. Right? So these two line contradiction carries on, but it transforms and changes dynamic.
Yeah.
Within the ANC, the line of national self-determination comes and is represented by the Youth League.
Yes.
And this, I said it when the EFF was coming about, when we had a lecture at Phyllis at Philippi. And I said, if you move from this trajectory, you have taken a correct step, but do not lose it. Because you cannot carry two things. You cannot carry the cries and the calls, the clarion call of Lambede, and carry that which negated Lambede through the Freedom Charter. If somebody remembers, I beg you, that sharpen the contradiction within the EFF. Raise the line of Lambede as the commanding line of your new generation. Post betrayal in 1994.
Because
that struggle is still there.
In that struggle, I mean, this is too.
That struggle is still there. But we are not the only one affected by this contradiction. The whole national liberation movement is affected by this contradiction. It is, in actual terms, a class contradiction.
Both.
A contradiction between those Africans who have been bourgeoisified. And if I may, and find close proximity with the interests of the metropolitan bourgeoisie. The metropolitan bourgeoisie is the imperial bourgeoisie. And the contradiction between those Africans who still yearn for national liberation, independence, nation building, and self-determination.
Come on.
We have this contradiction. We have it in peace. We have it in Nazapo. We see it in the ANC as well, in the EFF.
Yeah.
We have this contradiction. It expresses itself in the declarations that are made by our leaders. They say one thing the following morning, they negate what they said yesterday. I'm not saying be condemnful of your movement. All I'm saying is that sharpen the contradiction.
Yeah, man.
Sharpen the contradiction. There must be identification and division.
Yes.
We must identify the forces for the completion of the national liberation agenda, versus being the forces for its cultivation. Because the threat of the national liberation agenda of the African people is cultivationism. Or in simple terms, it is neocolonialism. The fact of the matter is this, understand this. I said we were conquered and South Africa was built upon our backs. And we were never South Africans until what? 1994. 1994 we were incorporated into the settler neo-colonial house. Right? We became, from being slaves on the field, we became slaves serving in the master's house. Malcolm X called it the house niggers. We became glorified house niggers. Now, you want to bring the question of niggerism, because our politics, our thinking, and our intellectual culture is dominated by niggerism, the thinking, and one form of it came in a very popular book that was published by one author, Nigerian popular author, Chika Onyeni, where he said that, look, if you're a nigger, you're a surviving nigger, yeah? You're a money-making nigger, man, you know? It's niggerism, niggerism, fine, some of us can make it. In fact, the problem with our politics today is that we're led by house niggers. But niggerism does not liberate. It does not free the national productive forces from the ownership of foreign hands or from foreign hands' ownership. It does not liberate. Right? It compels us to betray more. Right? And the worst aspect of niggerism is that it's neocolonialism which has gone mad. And the typical example is the failed state in Somalia. Nigeria today, right? You, Liberia. That is the culture of niggerism. And niggerism is in essence barbarism. Because if I am to eat you, right? To survive and to make a deal with my master, I will do so. And this is not new. And I know this is painful. It seems as if we are turning the light back inward when we say slavery did not just happen by itself. There were internal collaborators. There were collaborators within who collaborated with the Arabs and the Europeans. They were collaborators. There is never a one-way street in any situation or phenomenon. And this process has not stopped. Just as we've had collaborators during the era of slave raids, and we had collaborators during the era of the resistance wars, led by inside others, and the last one, Babata. We had collaborators in the era since 1912 and 1994. I hope at some point we will have a discussion around the two-line struggle, just purely on the two-line struggle. Because there's an aspect I would like to bring and contextualize historically, the aspect of UDF and its role as a counter-revolutionary movement. And I know this one, I can make. And also it was an Oppenheimer project that we did. But that we can discuss at some point. So I begin by saying Europe conquered and South Africa as it was built upon ourselves. 1994 was an incorporation of the dispossessed and oppressed African masses into South Africa. So it was never meant to work. It's not a problem or question of efficiency and efficiency. And the question of corruption, I want to really contextualize corruption. You see, every class in history must have a material base from which to produce and reproduce itself. It is in this context that you talk about black corruption in Africa. Oh, African leaders are corrupt. Oh, African civil servants are corrupt. These are aspiring bourgeois, petty bourgeois class, but it doesn't have an independent material base to produce itself. So it takes from the state coffers. It is illogical. It is logic. Neocolonialism demands that for it to be sustained, it must have this class. So it's not something that is outside of the culture and the logic of neocolonialism. So if you want to stop corruption, you must take a polar opposite stance or position. We must fight and roll back the frontiers of reaction. You can't resolve the land question through parliament comments. I am not saying there won't be an expropriation. It will, because the legal term, concept, expropriation without compensation, is not necessarily anti-colonialist or anti-capitalist. It's not. Capitalism does that. The capitalists among themselves, they expropriate one another. It speaks to the competition among the capitalists themselves. What is interesting about ourselves is that you have the emerging and aspiring so-called class project, black class project, bourgeois. It doesn't have its own independent material base to produce and reproduce itself as a class. So it screams and screams in parliament and come up with these laws with the hope that they will be passed. And you know what's going to happen after that? Each one among themselves. It does not resolve the question of property relations in society. It does not resolve capitalist relations. It does not resolve colonial relations, property relations in society. It simply gives them life by giving them a black face. When we talk about land, we talk about the complete aesthetic, like Comrade Lega said, we're not talking about some large piece of land somewhere unproductive. We are actually talking about the whole complete material base, which is in itself a stance against capitalism, is a stance against colonialism, is a stance against imperialism, and everything that comes out. Yeah. That call in Parliament is not a revolution call, it's a reformist call.
Yes.
Because our mandate for us to arrive at the point of national liberation, we must understand that we, when we talk about the land, we talk about the land in the context that we will take it and we will organize the patterns for the relations of ownership over the land and the means of production in such a way that we usher ourselves into a new historical epoch.
I don't get it!
We don't want coexistence! We don't want to coexist with imperialism. The African Revolution is by its nature, by its historical context, Mao puts it so simply, beautifully. I'm a fanatic among them. Mao says, Mao traces the genesis of imperialism. He says, imperialism rose and throve out of the enslavement of black people. And it will only finally come to an end when all the peoples are free. Mao just sums up the whole historical epoch in a few sentences, in one paragraph.
Yeah.
This is the context of our struggle.
Yeah.
We're not struggling to coexist. We're not struggling to have coexistence, not integrate with imperialism, nor settler colonialism, nor capitalism. Remember, we are the base that this house is built on.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if the base of the foundation moves, this house must fall. This is a month of Sobukwe and Shabu. I therefore cannot lie to you. I don't want to be haunted by the spirit of our people who are lying, you know, dead and watching as we speak to you.
Viva Azadu!
This march that Mao talks about, just as I'm about to conclude, can you believe I'm not even reading my speech out of my head. This march, this context is important, right? Because I'm trying to arrive at this question of, is it a solution? I think I've partly answered it, but I want to give you now a universal context. As Mao says, imperialism rose and drove from the enslavement to black people, and if I get down to an end, then all black people are free. You know what this means? It means that for the African Revolution, whether we have already conceptualized it or not, or we are still going to conceptualize it, is actually the vanguard of the global revolution against imperialism. And our challenge right now is that we subject the leadership of this revolution to capitulations. A new revolutionary proletarian in orientation. Because when we talk about the proletarian, we're talking about the base of society. Must emerge and have a proletarian revolutionary leadership that can take us, remember, that can take us not from where we were. We cannot go back there. Also, we can't establish ourselves from what we are. And also, we cannot establish and bring what other people talked about, a human face to imperialism or capitalism. Africans must bring a higher synthesis. This is the significance of the African Revolution. It must take humanity beyond the shadows of the dark past that came with the advent of capitalism, white supremacy, and imperialism. So the Africans and the African Revolution must be conscious and self-conscious about this historical mission. Unfortunately, other people will say, oh God chose us to be here. I agree with you from a materialist perspective. And acknowledge if you say God is the laws of history and social development.
Yes.
But history chose for us to be here.
Yes.
And unfortunately, we carry a burden of not only liberating and saving ourselves, but the burden of also liberating and helping those who despise us. Such, unfortunately, is the burden dropped on your shoulders, on our shoulders, by history. By the extent of history, the fact that we constitute the base. Look, the relationship between our African revolution and imperialism, we must understand it, like Mao said, have an image of a pyramid or umlandato, right? What do you call that in English, umlandato? A triangle. Have an image of a triangle. And understand at the bottom of the triangle, there you have the material base and the social base that upholds imperialism. And in between, or in the middle of the triangle, you have the intermediary groups who are also exploited under imperialism countries. And then on the top, you have your whole ruling class of the world. Now, it does not matter, and I'm not saying it's insignificant what this middle group does. I'm not saying it's insignificant. But by the nature of the contradiction, it does not matter what they do. They can never change the structure. So when you say the character of our revolution is African, it doesn't mean that by saying African, you're saying other people cannot play the role. The Arabs must play the role because they have a contradiction in imperialism, right?
Yes.
And many other groups as well. The Asians must do the same, they have a contradiction in imperialism. But by the logic of the structure of how imperialism is built, the example is a project revolution. Another example is the Chinese revolution. Another example is the Bolivian revolution. They have all made their contribution. They have shook imperialism. They have never been able to bring it down. Because the foundation is still intact. So we need to stop behaving as if somebody owes us something out there. Our mission is so huge. In conclusion, our mission is so huge, comrades. You understand it? I'm trying to paint a picture so you understand this. You can't enter into the space of struggle on the basis where you think that there are other people who are going to come and help you. When they don't come, you blame them. And you find reason not to do so.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. We enter into the African Revolution knowing and conscious and deliberate and take self-responsibility for the outcomes of the revolution, whether good or bad. And we cannot enter with the mentality that somewhere, somehow, we have a WTO, a Security Council, a United Nations, where there's some kind of common moralism where we can convince them that some of the things they've been doing in the United States are wrong, and then they'll come to their senses. You can't do that. This is what our leaders are doing. It's embarrassing. It's embarrassing. You enter into the revolution with one idea and one aim: to conquer. You must conquer the world. You can only build and you can only lead the world only if you conquer it. And it is better to talk about peace from a national power than about peace from a national power. And there's the discussion. You see, this is what there is a nation of a very small nation in the world, globally, who runs the world, the Jewish government. After they've gone through their history of national humiliation, etc., 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 but they reach one point that never ever again shall we hear talk peace while we are bending down on knees.
Yeah.
Hey. I like that again. Never again shall we beg for peace. If there must be peace, and if there must be negotiations, we will do so. We will enforce it. Because we can, because we have power.
Yes.
The fundamental question that we must settle is the question of the seizure of power, comrades. That's what you must have, power. And to do this, you must understand, you must move from the position that Our struggle is a struggle of the reconquest of the land.
Yes.
And once we have reconquered the land, we form new relations of ownership and relations accruing from such patterns of ownership. A new mode of production which speaks to our interests as a people in Africa, in the diaspora, that they take the responsibility to be the leaders of the world. Isn't it?
Yeah.